So welcome back to our session on our second plenary session on protecting freedom in science. I would like to invite Mats Rosengren, who is a professor of rhetoric at the University of Uppsala, to give a talk on facts, truth, objectivity today. We are looking forward to a talk from the point of view of the humanities on the current situation in the world and how researchers can make their voice heard.
Well, thank you. Do you hear me now? No? It's on, but okay, I need to hold it, I guess. This will make it a bit, now you hear me now? Good. Thank you for the introduction, and I would like to thank Odysseus Panopoulos for giving me this invitation to come here and speak in front of you today. It is really an honor and a pleasure to be given the opportunity to speak in front of such an accomplished audience. And moreover, to speak on concerns that really engage us all in academia today. No matter if we are natural or social scientists, or if our domain is the humanities or the arts. You don't hear? Okay, I'm really bad with microphone techniques, so I'm sorry. You just tell me, wave a hand if I tend to do this. So, so I think that we are all in different ways engaged in what we are, in what I will be speaking about today. And I say this confidently because my topic today is my topic today concerns how we in academia can safeguard ideas of facts, truth, and objectivity in an era that seems to be taken over by the conviction that nothing is stable, nothing is reliable, and knowing amounts to nothing more than having an opinion. In my own research on epistemology, I've tried to articulate how it is possible both to pay heed to the very fundamental critiques that were directed against rationality, intentionality, objectivity, and truth towards the end of the 20th century, and still preserve a place for knowledge, fact, and truth within the sciences today. And here, as you may already have noticed, I use the term science in its most inclusive sense, encompassing not only natural or social sciences, but also the humanities and research in the fine arts as well. So I will use science in that sense all through my speech. In a nutshell, my argument is that even though we have to accept that all our human knowledge is just that, I mean human knowledge, such a relativization does not mean, not at all, that we have to abandon objectivity, knowing, and truth in favor of some kind of rampant relativism or post-factual condition. To spell this out a bit more, I will first say a few words about my own approach to epistemology, then articulate this approach further by presenting some crucial points made by the microbiologist and epistemologist Ludwig Fleck, whom some of you might know about, and by the political and social thinker Cornelius Castoriadis. And finally, I will sum up the consequences of my approach for how we may deal with knowing and knowledge claims today. So, what did I mean just a moment ago when I emphasized that our knowledge is human knowledge? As if anybody here would doubt such a statement. Okay. Speak.
Should I speak without the microphone?
People say, this is really a difficult one. Is that okay? Okay, so what did I mean a moment ago when I emphasized that our knowledge is human knowledge? As if anyone here would doubt such a statement. Of course, knowledge is formulated in different languages, conceived, used, and perfected by human beings. And in this sense, it's obviously human. But I claim more than that. Even the content of our knowledge is inevitably related to us humans, to our specific capacities and embodiments. And since I am a rhetorician by trade, I base this claim in the Greek antiquity, in the Platonic distinction between episteme and doxa. The sophist Protagoras was perhaps the first in the history of Western thought to assume what I would call a doxological as opposed to epistemological position, meaning that he chose human imperfection, fluctuating belief and unforeseeable change instead of Platonic immobility and certainty. His most famous dictum, the so-called Homo Mensura fragment, is perhaps the most poignant expression of this position. And it says, "Of all things the measure is man, of things that are, that they are, of things that are not, that they are not." What we learn from Protagoras is that no apprehension, not even of nature or other animals, escapes these anthropomorphic conditions of knowledge alluded to in the fragment. For instance, that our knowledge is always formulated and or preserved in some language, institution or ritual. It is practiced and upheld by one or many individuals, always in one historic moment or other within the admittedly diffuse framework of an ever-changing but still specific social situation. All these factors are co-determining our knowledge, making it a part of a fluctuating, always changing doxic situation. Thus, one should avoid the term epistemology when talking about a human conception of knowledge. Through its entrenched meaning, the term epistemology carries and propagates a conception of knowledge that is at odds with the perspective I try to outline here. Ancient philosophy, as already mentioned by Sophie, at least in its different Platonic versions, saw true knowledge, episteme, as the result of direct insight, theoria, into how the world is. Thus, epistemic knowledge supposedly gives access to reality independent of man. Ancient rhetoric, on the other hand, saw knowledge as inseparably linked to doxa, that is, roughly what is held to be true, what is believed, and what is taken for granted within a larger or smaller group of people. Doxa does not reveal reality as it is in itself, but as it appears to us, being the kinds of beings that we are, with the kind of perceptual organs that we possess. Doxic knowledge presents us with an eminently human world, not least since it is through our embodied logos that we have shaped the doxa that present the world just as it appears to us. So, rather than calling the rhetorical Protagorean view of knowledge an epistemology or a theory of knowledge, I would like to name it doxology, a term that the 17th century philosopher Leibniz once used to designate a way of speaking that adjusts itself to appearance, to opinions, and to practice. But I would like to avoid the somewhat pejorative undertones in Leibniz's characterization and present doxology not as a teaching about apparent or illusory knowledge, but as a teaching about situated, objective, and relevant knowledge. And for those of you who are native English speakers, you would know that the term doxology already has a strong meaning within theology, as being part of the Mass where you praise God. This is, not, of course, not the meaning that I allude to when I use the term doxology. It was first coined in Swedish, and in Swedish we don't have any term doxology that has the sense in English. When I use the term doxology, I use it in this sort of ancient philosophical rhetorical way. So just so you know. Thus, doxic knowledge makes no claim to be eternal or unchangeable. Doxic knowledge is always knowledge in a social and historical situation. It is, as the philosopher and scientist Donna Haraway would say, situated. It is made up of what is thought to be evident and true within specific contexts, as well as of belief in facts, values, prevailing in a certain society, a certain group, a certain discipline at a certain time. It is made up of a social consensus about what is and what should be the case. But how, should one ask here, is such a consensus to be conceived of within the sciences? A pertinent answer to this question is given by is given in the works of Ludwig Fleck. He claims that the objectivity of scientific knowledge is dependent on at least three different factors: the thought collective, the thought style, and what he calls active and passive connections. In a book written already in 1935, Genesis and Development of a Scientific Fact, Fleck presents what was to become the dominating perspective on knowledge and knowledge formation in the humanities and the social sciences towards the end of the last century. As an immediate forerunner to Thomas Kuhn and his notion of paradigm, and in a more indirect way to Michel Foucault and his thoughts on objects of knowledge as being products of discourses and discursive formations, Fleck stands out as one of the most important thinkers within the modern field of epistemology and theory of science. In his comparative epistemology, Fleck does not envisage knowledge as a simple relation between an individual seeking to know and an object about which the individual has or wants to have knowledge. That is, he does not conceive of knowledge in terms of a dual relation of the type A knows that P. He presents his position in the following manner. In comparative epistemology, cognition must not be construed as only a dual relationship between the knowing subject and the object to be known. The existing fund of knowledge must be a third party in this relation as a basic factor of all new knowledge. What is already known influences in the particular method of cognition, and cognition in turn enlarges, renews, and gives fresh meaning to what is already known. Cognition is therefore not an individual process of any theoretical particular consciousness. Rather, it is the result of a social activity, since the existing stock of knowledge exceeds the range available to any one individual. Thus, Flex understands knowledge neither as just an individual nor as an exclusively social phenomena. Knowledge is always the outcome of a process involving three factors: the individual looking for knowledge, the social, historical, practical, discursive, I would say doxic situation, and the object about which the knowledge is sought. Compared to Protagoras, Fleck has more precise conceptual tools to work with. Where the old sophist had recourse to the somewhat crude distinction between doxa and epistema, Fleck is able to be far more specific and nuanced, as here, where he presents the difference between experimentation and experience. Whereas an experiment can be interpreted in terms of a simple question and answer, experience must be understood as a complex state of intellectual training based upon the interaction involving the knower, that which he already knows, and that which he has yet to learn. Among the conceptual tools developed by am I on the right? I'm not. What's this? Strange. This is the one I just read to you. I'm sorry. Sort of. And perhaps I should mention that the text should really be white as well. And there are stuff that are in the back that you don't see, but take that as a doxic thing. Anyways, like the interaction involving the knower, that which is already he already knows, and that which he has yet to learn, that is like the triplet here. And among the conceptual tools developed by Fleck to conduct his investigation of cognition, the most important are the concepts thought collective, thought style, and active and passive connections, as I mentioned before. So, what is a thought style? A thought style distinguishes and demarcates a thought collective, which in turn is the basis for the style, since the style is born by the collective. Can we really learn anything from such an obvious conceptual circle? Yes, I believe we most definitely can. This circularity highlights both the discursive historical, the style, and the social historical, the collective aspects of our knowledge, as well as the fact that these aspects are inextricably united. In short, the circularity shows us just how imminent our epistemological position is, has ever been, and will always be. For each thought style, certain epistemic relations appear as passive. That is, as given, as evident, as facts that simply are there, that is, as something that is real. While other connections appear as active, that is, as more or less conventional results of man's striving to understand and comprehend. Once a point of departure has been chosen, once an hypothesis or a certain axiom is considered true, or at least probable, then a certain amount of other knowledge will follow. And this knowledge, which is always relative to a specific situation, tradition, or discipline, tends to present itself in the guise of objectivity and evidence. The active moment that is always present in every act of cognition is, as it were, repressed. Thus, we remain, most of the time, ignorant of how how active and creative our cognition really is. Fleck writes in his preface that we are no longer conscious of our own participation in perception. Instead, we feel a complete passivity in the face of a power that is independent of us, a power we call existence or reality. If Fleck is right, then the question of truth in science can never be a simple question of correspondence with the world as it really is, independent of all disciplinary methods and techniques and discourses. Fleck is quite explicit on this point. And now I hope that, yes. Truth is not relative and certainly not subjective in the popular sense of the word. It is always, or almost always, completely determined within a thought style. One can never say that the same thought is true for A and false for B. If A and B belong to the same thought collective, the thought will be either true or false for both. But if they belong to different thought collectives, it will just not be the same thought. It must be either unclear to or be understood differently by one of them. Truth is not a convention, but rather one, in a historical perspective, an event in the history of thought, or two, in its contemporary context, a stylized thought constraint. So, to sum up Fleck's position here, what we perceive, we perceive that which we are able to perceive, given our bodily makeup and the abilities and techniques we have acquired through education, physical and mental training, habit and praxis. In science, this means that a novice looking into the microscope is not able to discern what a trained scientist has learned to see. But the process transforming a novice into a fully-fledged scientist is not a process where an individual learns to see all that there is to see. No, the individual learns to see what she is what is supposed to be there to be seen. Given the doxic conditions provided by the thought collective and the thought style of the discipline to which the individual belongs. And now I come to my second part, because what I just said leaves us with a difficult conundrum. If we humans perceive only that which we are supposed to perceive, how on earth can we learn anything new? And how did we get the knowledge we have in the first place? The Greek-French philosopher Cornelius Castoriadis, who worked and lived in Paris up until his death in 97, used to talk about this as the problem of the new. Castoriadis was, all through his political and theoretical work, an unrelenting champion of autonomy, of its importance, its history, and its possibilities, not least in epistemological matters. He insisted upon the necessity of accepting that we humans constantly create new forms in and for our world. That is, we humans do create an objective reality for ourselves on every level, from the biological umwelt, through our social and political activities, and most importantly in this context, also in science. Imagination, Castoriadis claims, is what makes it possible for us human beings to refuse the heteronomy of the sensational world and to consciously create a world of our own. Each organism, he claims, is autonomous in the sense that it will always have its own world, its umwelt. And this umwelt is species dependent. Man is, of course, autonomous in this sense as well, just as any organism is. But according to Castoriadis, the full sense of autonomy comes first with imagination, the possibility of consciously creating and institutionalizing in behavior, language, representation, buildings, techniques, etc., social imaginary significations, which is a specific term of his. And he calls these significations social because they are shared by many people, and imaginary, not because they are fictitious, but because they are produced by the faculty we humans have of imagining and imagining new things. And significations because it relates to our human need to create, to make sense of and in our world, to make meaning. So, autonomy proper for Castoriadis thus involves a conscious dealing with the creation of a human world. That is, with something that goes far beyond and in a certain sense precedes the problems of an individual choosing between alternatives. And he writes, the self-institution of society is the creation of a human world, of things, reality, language, norms, values, ways of life and death, objects for which we live and objects for which we die. And of course, first and foremost, the creation of the human individual in which the institution of society is massively embedded. So, for Castoriadis, the solution to the problem of the new is to reject the notion of us humans as passively facing a ready-made reality. Instead, he insists upon our capacity to create the new, that is to create new forms, new ideas in and for our world. And he writes, there is creation in being, or more precisely, being is creation, vis formandi. not creation of matter energy, but creation of forms. What is the point in adopting a term with such a loaded history? On the one hand, to end the subterfuges and the sophistries concerning the question of the new. Either there is creation, or the history of being, and consequently of humanity too, is an interminable repetition or an eternal return. And this is where Fleck and Castoriadis interestingly intersect. Neither of them see the human subject as autonomous, as an autonomous free subject in the liberal or neoliberal sense that is like the current notion today. Castoriadis, for instance, he would emphasize the importance of not confusing social and political autonomy with simple freedom of choice. But and nor do Fleck and Castoriadis reject the possibility of specific individual contribution to the general human creation of knowing and knowledge. Both see the human agent as socially situated and conditioned, but not determined. And hence, both of them move beyond the barren opposition of freedom and determinism and open the field for exploring doxic knowledge. So, and now I come to part three, namely, what does a doxological stance then imply when it comes to the general possibilities of answering questions concerning hypotheses, and the validity of interpretation within the sciences? And in a chapter in his famous book, The Mind in the Cave, the reference to Plato and his simile of the cave is obvious already in the title here, of course. The Mind in the Cave, from 2002, the South African archaeologist David Lewis Williams sums up some criteria by which scientists judge and compare hypotheses that according to him, have to be met for a scientific theory or explanation to be acceptable. I will use these criteria as a base for spelling out a doxological approach to the questions of facts, hypotheses, and truths. The criteria represent fairly well what I take to be the current consensus in academia when it comes to evaluating hypotheses, judging facts, and assessing interpretations within the sciences and academia in general. So Lewis Williams' first point is that a scientific explanation of a phenomena must accord with the received well-supported general work as well as overall theory. Secondly, he continues, an hypothesis must be internally consistent. That is, it must depend in all its part on the same premise, and the parts must not contradict one another. His third criterion is that an hypothesis that covers diverse field of evidence is more persuasive than one that pertains only to one narrow type of evidence. Fourthly, a hypothesis that must be such that verifiable empirical facts can be deduced from it. That is, that a hypothesis must relate explicitly to observable features of data. Fifthly, he concludes, useful hypotheses have heuristic potential. That is, they lead on to further questions and research. Up to a certain point, I find these criteria to be both sensible and reasonable to adopt when trying to evaluate a suggested theory, hypothesis, or interpretation of any kind of phenomena. But from a doxological point of view, it's not immediately evident how we are to understand them. For example, how are we to understand the implicit separation of interpretation from fact, of explanation from interpretation, or for that matter, of evidence from illusion present in Lewis Williams's reasoning? All these distinctions seem to be unproblematic for Lewis Williams, at least on the programmatic level, whereas they all need to be qualified before they can be accepted as doxological tools. So let me take a brief look at the criteria one by one and try to spell out what it would mean to approach them in a doxological way. So the first part of the first criterion, as you see, an explanation of a phenomena must accord with received well-supported general work. That first part is, in a sense, very doxological in that it sort of complies with the always already existing, pre-existing knowledge within the discipline or the field. As Fleck would say, the existing fund of knowledge must be a third party in this relation, that is, in cognition, as a basic factor of all new knowledge. Hence, the first part is quite uncontroversial for me. The second part, on the other hand, that the explanation must accord with overall theory, is more problematic. Judging from the example presented by Lewis Williams, and this the example he gives is that one cannot explain an aberration in a planet's orbit by invoking laser beams directed at it from living beings in the vicinity of Alpha Centauri. So, according to this example, this part of the criterion is heavily dependent on a specific version of what one could call the scientific common sense in the beginning of the 21st century in the Anglo-Saxon world. That one cannot evoke lasers used by living beings on Alpha Centauri is simply not true. Of course, one can invoke such an explanation. Most of us would agree with Lewis Williams that it is a bad explanation, or even that it is plainly wrong. But this is not in itself enough to dismiss it. Just recall Michel Foucault's statement about Mendel, who evidently told the truth, but who was not received within the true in the biological discourse of his time. Just recall that to realize how shaky and misleading such evidences may be. From a doxological standpoint, the evoking of Alpha Centauri activities cannot be dismissed by a simple reference to overall theory. One has to show why, in this specific case, this specific explanation is insufficient or unacceptable in relation to the knowledge claim made. Thus, in this case, the doxological stance does not necessarily imply a change in what is conceived of as an acceptable explanation of a fact or an acceptable solution to a problem, but it does imply a change in attitude towards what seems to be evidently wrong or simply strange. The foundation of doxic knowledge can never be the experience of evidence, nor a reference to what is given. It has to be construed each time within the specific field and discipline, using the specific accepted methods, styles, and practices of the field, always keeping in mind that the construction might have been different and may become so in the near future. And the second criterion, that an hypothesis must be internally consistent, is also acceptable within a doxological notion of science. I don't really see what it would mean not to accept such a criterion. Really, it wouldn't be understandable. But with the important precaution that one cannot treat the notion of consistency as something absolute. What is and what is not consistent depends upon, among other things, how narrowly or how wildly one needs to define the terms, or as the case may be, the actions, the practices, the notions in a specific situation. For a certain type of philosophy, it's quite inconsistent to claim that Socrates is both immortal and a man. For another type, it's quite acceptable. It all depends on how one understands, or perhaps chooses to define, immortality. The, un- The understanding and the reasons for choosing are always dependent upon the doxa of the field, the thought style of the discipline, upon choosing, upon your position in the field, as well as upon your reasons for defining the notion, action, habit, etc. in question. That is, it is dependent upon what you want to do with the definition or notion in question that you're working with. Regardless of if consistency is a well and unequivocally defined concept within certain domains in the scientific field, it always needs to be put in relation with the ever-changing doxic situation and conditions in the specific field and the specific situation that conditions knowledge in the field that you're working in. So, the third criterion, that an hypothesis that covers diverse fields of evidence is more persuasive than one that pertains only to one narrow type of evidence. This criterion is an interestingly, at least for me, rhetorical one. It differs from the other two in making claims about what is more persuasive. That is, it makes a general and even universalistic claim about the presumed effect of a certain kind of hypothesis on every kind of audience. Again, I'm not disagreeing here with Lewis Williams about the content of the criterion. No doubt, it may be shown, both historically and within contemporary science, that such hypotheses have been and are more generally accepted than hypotheses with narrower scopes. But what does that mean, really? The example given by Lewis Williams is once more telling. He says, for example, if the theory of gravity is applied only to inanimate objects, such as tennis balls, and not to living creatures, such as people, its explanatory value would be so limited that scientists would reject it, which is probably true. The example does state something that is no doubt true about a specific kind of audience, that is, scientists, in relation to a specific explanation of why what goes up must come down. The force of the example, though, its persuading effect upon us, readers of Lewis Williams, depends upon our presumed perceived notions. Preconceived notions about what kind of interest scientists have. We tend, or are supposed to think, that a scientist is someone who is interested in formulating general laws for everything, and that it is the reason why they would not content themselves with an explanation that only concerned inanimate objects. So the criterion that seemed to be universally valid is in fact only valid within a relation to a certain notion of science and scientists, which again makes a case for promoting doxological notions of situatedness, dependence upon historical and disciplinary conditions, as well as upon specific interests of the actors involved. Plainly speaking, a narrow hypothesis may be just as persuasive as a broad one. It all depends on the situation, the field, the doxa, the actors, the history of the field, and the personal history of the actors, the pre-existing knowledge on who the orator has announced the hypothesis and who receives it, the audience, and on the actual power structure within the relationship between all these factors within the field in question, and so forth. The fourth criterion is a classical empirical one. One must be able to deduce verifiable empirical facts from an hypothesis. It must relate to explicitly observable features of data. This may seem quite straightforward. The hypothesis is supposed to say something about the world that can be verified as either true or false by looking at the world and seeing how the world is. But from a doxological point of view, there is no way the world is in and for itself. What we see is formed by ourselves, our bodily makeup, our concepts, our presuppositions and our interests, and we have no way of knowing whether or when our hypotheses correspond to the world as it is. Therefore, this criterion must be understood as stating something about the requirements in force within the scientific field, discipline or doxa that you are working with, but not a truth about science or research in general. It may very well be the case that most so-called empirical sciences cherish some version of this criterion. Nevertheless, its application has to be determined and discussed specifically in each case. Thus, the doxological position does not endorse relativism in the traditional sense. We need to distinguish facts from guesses, truths from illusions, knowing from believing. But we have to make these distinctions in the full awareness that they are our own constructions, fabrications made by ourselves in order to deal with a human world that is ours, and that their validity is, and has always been, confined within our, by humans measure made, version of the world. I'm coming now to the last criterion and towards the end of my speech. So Lewis Williams' fifth criterion is of a slightly different kind, again. It tells us that useful hypotheses should have a heuristic potential. That is, that they should be able to lead on to further research questions and research. And in a way, this is, of course, a very doxological criterion, since what is useful and what is to be counted as further questions has to be identified as such, not only in relation to the already existing bodies of knowledge, but also in relation to the specific interests and desires within and between the disciplines, the epistemic fields, the scientists, the cultures, etc. What is and what is not a fruitful hypothesis or a further question has to be determined in a specific case with hindsight as well as foresight, and with as clear as possible notion of the constraints and possibilities contained within the doxa in vigor. The yardstick for judging whether a certain hypothesis has heuristic potential or not is always to test it within a discipline or an epistemic field according to the methods that are considered to be sound within the thought collective and see what results it may yield. Its eventual usefulness may, in happy cases, be judged completely from within the discipline or the field. More often than not, it is the result of a negotiation between scientific, personal, economic, political, and institutional interests. So, transformed according to the comments I just made, I think that these criteria may work within a doxological, rhetorical approach to science as well. And so, what Fleck and Castoriadis show us is that the urgent issue in science is not to decide whether or not there really is such a thing as objectivity, or if we can decide once and for all what is a fact or what truth really is. No, they show us that what we need to focus on is the processes of objectification, of objectivation within the sciences. And the reason why we should focus on the processes of objectivation is, for one thing, to see that there are different ways of obtaining scientifically sustainable facts and truths. Each disciplinary domain, physics as well as history, the study of literature as well as sociology, art and chemistry, just to name a few, have developed its own proper procedures, discourses and practices over the years and the centuries. They have, often painstakingly and slowly, formed and refined their own thought styles and shaped their own thought collectives, deciding on what knowing and knowledge, what competences are required by anyone who wants to become part of and act within these disciplines or these fields. Through history, we have seen the development of different notions of how to establish facts, of what is to be counted as true, and of how to distinguish between pure guesses and actual knowing. And it is only if one clings to the idea that all of these should be brought together in a coherent and consistent total science, that one would be forced to try to decide which truth, which objectivity, and which facts are really true. Still, such decisions are, as we know all too well, they are taken daily. But they are political and ideological in the narrow sense. In any case, not scientifically sound in that they are not based in upon the autonomous consensus of the scientists working within the disciplinary fields in question. In such ideological and political decisions, that resurrect the barren dichotomies between objectivity and subjectivity, between knowledge and relativism, that we in the scientific community should have left behind a long time ago. So, thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Professor Rosengren, for this very nice talk. I don't know if there's time for questions. I certainly have one. Is that as researchers, we're required to produce excellent research with impact, and this means that we have to produce new hypotheses, new results, new conclusions. And that the basis of the movement from alchemy to chemistry was a book by Robert Boyle in the 17th century called The Skeptical Chemist. That means that we confront anything that is new with skepticism and disbelief first before we believe anything and accept it as a fact. And this is something that in the current world, that if new ideas aren't confronted with skepticism, and kind of bogus ideas are accepted as fact, that this is for scientists and researchers a big problem.
You want me to comment upon that, or do you have a specific question?
Specific question. No. Just a comment.
No, I mean I think actually the question of the new and what can be counted as new, and how to deal with developments within sciences. I mean, the humanities or the natural sciences, whatever, is of course almost always met with skepticism when you first try to introduce a new idea. I mean, I mentioned Mendel, he's a case in point. And of course, your example is good as well. But I mean, what my claim here is that we need to look at how each discipline has sort of organized itself around its how the science is practiced, and sort of both acknowledge the fact that we need the inertia in the institution of science, and we need the critical aspects, we need the questioning, we need what you talked about this morning, about sort of like the scientist taking responsibility, looking into where does this development lead to, what would be the political and social consequences of it, and criticize the science from within there as well. But what we need to defend is the possibility for scientists of all colors to be autonomous in the Castoriadian sense of the world. I mean, to define their own laws and sort of judge their own research by its own standards, which is not the same as saying that they should stay within the ivory tower, not at all. But it's the judging of what is and what is not good research, and what is like what is validly new that I'm focusing on. Yeah.
I'm sure that we could have lots of questions about this talk, but unfortunately we have another session beginning more or less straight away. In the Aula Menor, which is just beside where registration was, we have a session on pensions for mobile researchers. So anybody who wants to leave this auditorium to go there, please do so now. In this auditorium we will have a session on science to business, researcher to employer, and so about the startup landscape. And I would ask you to give a big round of applause for Professor Rosengren.